afraid my dogs ain't got a lead. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and greed. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. Don't lose hope while Sunday's coming. Devil, you're done, you better start running. Friday's good 'cause Sunday's coming. So we let those soldiers take a knee as his friend betrayed him with a kiss. There before the mocking crowd, like a lamb to the slaughter, didn't make a sound. And he carried that cross to Calvary, and he shed his blood to set us free. As the nails went in and the sky went dark, the world was on his heart. Friday's good 'cause Sunday is coming. Don't lose hope 'cause Sunday is coming. Yeah.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Happy Easter and welcome to Mulder Church. My name is Hunter Bethay. I'm the associate pastor here. And if this is one of your first times worshiping with us, we have these connect cards out on the resource table in the lobby. And we would love for you to fill one of these out, let us know a little bit about you, and then turn it into the welcome desk. And we've got a gift that we would like to give you to welcome you. Also, if you have kids anywhere from birth up through sixth grade and you want them to join our other kids down in Kidstown for their Easter celebration, you can take them out the back doors, down the sloped hallway, and down the steps, and you'll enter into Kidstown. We are so delighted to be worshiping our risen Savior with you this morning. Would you stand as we continue to worship together?
Come on, let's get ready. Lift our voice and give Jesus the praise that he deserves this morning. He has done great things. He has been. And let's sing this out.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. Oh, hey!
continue to sing out. Let's sing our praises to him for what he has done for us. So this song is just simply called What He's Done. So if you will, let's lift our voice. Let's sing it together.
God, as we gather here today in this place, on the morning of the first day of the week, we pray that you would help us to celebrate your presence and experience the revelation that those first witnesses did so many years ago on that first Easter day, that Christ is not dead, that he is no longer buried, that he is risen and alive, and that God, you are with us right now to offer your grace, your mercy, your power. Lord, it doesn't look like Easter is true for so many reasons. And as we come from all kinds of places, spiritually and emotionally today, to celebrate the resurrection, we see dead things all around us. We see things that are not as you want them and as we want them. But Lord, today in this space, would you help us to believe Easter anyway? God, even though sickness, would you help us believe Easter anyway? Even though family relationships are not what we would have them to be, what we want them to be, would you help us believe Easter anyway? God, even though war riddles our world, and God, so much brokenness fills the news every day we flip it on, would you help us to believe Easter anyway? And right now in this place, Jesus, would you help us catch a fresh vision of you, the risen King, ruling and reigning? And would you, Lord, do a change in us that we might be part of how you're changing the world? Would you help us believe it? Would you help us receive it? Lord, we love you and we thank you in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, church.
Happy Easter. I'm Caleb.
And I'm Lily.
And we're so glad you're here celebrating the resurrection of Jesus in person and online.
If you're a member of Mulder Church, we invite you to give a tithe or offering as a part of our worship. We practice giving God our first and best as a reminder that He also owns the rest.
If you're worshiping in person, you can put your tithe or offering in the offering box out in the hallway. You can also text the word GIVE to 334-500-3454 and follow the prompts. To give online, go to MulderChurch.com and click the online giving. Or you can mail a check to 3454 Fire Tower Road, Wetumpka, Alabama, 36093.
If you have a child who's currently in 3rd through 6th grade, registration for Camp Kidstown is currently open. This summer, our kids will be returning to Camp Chandler for a week of fun, worship, and life-changing encounters with Jesus. The dates are June 2nd through 5th. The packets are available outside the church office or at the Kidstown desk downstairs.
Lily and I are part of the student ministry here at Mulder. We are also looking forward to a life-changing trip this summer as a team of our youth go on a mission to Arkansas. We're doing several fundraisers to offset the cost of the trip. The past few weeks, we've had several empty Blue Ridge water jugs out in the hallways around the campus for people to donate their loose pocket change. Change for change.
Beginning next Sunday, we will be selling one-of-a-kind Mulder t-shirts. They will be gray comfort colors with our logo on the front and a picture of our church and mission statement on the back. We'll have a table set up in the hallway where you can purchase shirts, costing $25 to $30 depending on size.
Finally, we would love to wash your car on Sunday, April 14th. A team of our youth will be out in the parking lot from 3 to 5 p.m., so bring your vehicles and invite your neighbors too.
We're glad you're here today on Easter as we conclude our current sermon series, Altar. We hope you'll come back next week as we start our new sermon series called The Greatest Sermon Ever. Wait, is Pastor Jonathan really calling it The Greatest Sermon Ever?
Well, yeah, that's because it's not about his sermon. It's about Jesus' most famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. It's gonna be epic.
Oh, well now here's Pastor Jonathan with part 7 of Altar.
Surrender is a profound display of faith. It's loosening our grasp on control and inviting God to take the lead.
Surrender your worries, your fears.
Surrender, grow, and transform.
Release control. Surrender is freedom.
In surrender, brokenness becomes a canvas for God's masterpiece.
So let us breathe deeply and enter into this space of surrender. Let us quiet the noise within and open our hearts to receive. Come to the altar. Here we encounter God. We encounter freedom. We encounter peace. Here we find ourselves altered.
Well, good morning. Thank you for celebrating Easter with us at Mulder Church. Thank you for those of you worshiping from where you are online. My name is Pastor Jonathan, and it is so good to be together on this Resurrection Day. So we're going to read the first story of Easter from Matthew's Gospel. So if you have a Bible and want to turn there, I'm going to be reading from Matthew 27, starting in verse 50, and then I'll pick up a few verses in Matthew 28, and the words will be on the screen as well. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. Have you heard this part of the story? They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified. And they exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Can we just pause and appreciate the irony of that line real quick? The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So this is the Easter story. And as I listen to it, that line catches me the way it begins, because Matthew is trying to say that God has done something that has now changed everything. And he gives all these signs that things are different now. And the very first one that he records is also recorded in the book of Mark, that there's a curtain in the temple that is torn in two from top to bottom. Now, if that's foreign to you, the temple in Jesus' day was the permanent location of the presence of God. It was the only place that God's presence was thought to dwell all the time. And the people of God would go up to the temple to worship him there. And it was thought that his presence was behind this curtain. And only one person was allowed to go behind this curtain one day a year on the Day of Atonement, the high priest. And it says the curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. And here's why I think Matthew starts with that, because he wants us to see that something very special has happened that God has never done in the history of his people. And that is that God has left the temple. Ever since the temple was built, it was the place where God's presence dwelt. And when that curtain tore, it was a sign to all of his people and even the people looking on that God had left the temple. This is a big deal. It's such a big deal that I'm wondering if you'd be willing to say this with me together today. Because when we say things out loud, it helps us learn, and it's part of trying to begin to believe what we're saying. Okay, so if you're willing, read this with me. God has left the temple. Wow, thank you. That was courageous. I feel like as you were willing to say that with me, we kind of read it. We were like, yeah, what does that mean? Is that a good thing? Isn't that a bad thing that God has left the temple? And I can't help but think that maybe his disciples and other people didn't see this as a good sign. Certainly the disciples who had followed Jesus and just watched him die felt like they had lost this presence. And now the curtain is torn. God has left the temple. It's like they would feel this absence that they had been enjoying for several years, that God's people had been enjoying for a long time. At least there was some way they could be with God. And it reminds me of a phrase that has become really popular in our culture, that even though I wasn't around for the origin of this phrase, I've heard it since I was a little kid. You've probably heard it. It's really overused. Elvis has left the building. Right? And I was so curious as to why this became so popular and so overused, and it's because it happened at a climactic night that became famous. On December 15th, 1956, Elvis was performing at a radio show that later became a TV show called the Louisiana Hayride. And this was Elvis's last appearance at the Louisiana Hayride, and he was one of many musical groups and artists that night, and he was on in the middle of the lineup, in the middle of the night, and they were expecting such a crowd that they moved the event from Shreveport's Municipal Auditorium at the edge of downtown to what was then the new Hirsch Memorial Coliseum on the grounds of the Louisiana State Fair. So they were ready for all these people because everybody wanted to see the king. And this is an actual historical picture of that night. And when Elvis got done, everyone was so riled up that they would not settle down. And that's where the famous quote came in. Because the announcer, whose name was Horace Logan, he's now famous for this, he got on the microphone and he said, all right, Elvis has left the building. I've told you absolutely straight up to this point, you know that. He's left the building. He left the stage and went out the back with the policeman, and he is now gone from the building. And the reason he felt the need to say this is because the other performers weren't going to get a chance to go on. It's like he was saying, calm down. The king is gone. He's not coming back, and an encore is not possible at this point. And I can't help but wonder if that's how the followers of Jesus felt on Good Friday. That was the last time we were together as a church, was Friday evening, and we watched this candle representing the light of Christ be taken out as if the darkness had won. But this morning, we watched this light be ushered back in as if to say, no, the king did not leave. Darkness did not win. God leaving the temple was not a sign that the king was departing. God leading the temple was a sign that the king had come. That now God can't just be found in one location. God can be found in any location. Because God has done something so special, so amazing, and so unprecedented in Jesus that it changes how we have access to him forever. God has left the temple, and now he can be found in all kinds of places, in all kinds of situations. And while this might sound at first like bad news, it's actually really, really good news. And to appreciate just how good this news is, we have to go back to when the temple was important in the first place. In fact, we have to go back to before the temple was even a permanent building, to a book in your Bible you've probably never heard preached on Easter. I've never preached it on Easter. It's called the book of Leviticus. Some of you have never heard of it. Some of you have heard of it and don't like it. But it's where we've been as a church for 6 weeks, the book of Leviticus. And I've heard tell, I don't know, I haven't conducted a formal study, but I hear tell that the book of Leviticus, more than any book of the Bible, is responsible for making people quit their Bible reading plans. Like when you plan to read through the Bible in a year, people get this far and stop because it's so hard to read. There's so many details. It's so gross and bloody and gory, and nobody wants to have to do the stuff we read about, and it's just strange. And we even hear God in the story, and we say, that's not who I thought God was, and I don't know that I want to be in relationship with this God who makes his people do this stuff. But what we've been learning about the book of Leviticus is that it's all about access. Last week, Pastor Hunter preached that Leviticus starts in chapter 1, verse 1, with God speaking to Moses from inside this tent. The tent was the temporary structure that would one day become the temple. And God's presence was in the tent. But by chapter 9, we see that God's plan in Leviticus that he's fashioned is working. Because in chapter 9, he invites Moses and Aaron into the tent. And all of a sudden, his people are able to get closer. They're to offer these sacrifices as a way of dealing with their sin problem so that God can be close to them. God wants to be with his people. That's what we see in Leviticus, which is a beautiful idea. It's a beautiful truth that we find in the character of God, even in the hardest book of the Bible for some of us to read, is that God wants so desperately, and if he has to, he will fashion a system this elaborate just to be with his people and to allow his people to be with us. But it's complicated, and it's not easy. So Leviticus begins by telling us about these offerings. The first six chapters are about five offerings that we've been talking about. So we're going to summarize them real briefly. But the reason we're going to summarize them is because today, after this whole six-week sermon series, we're going to see how Jesus is the fulfillment of every offering we've been learning about. So first, in Leviticus 1, we learned about the burnt offering. And the burnt offering was to deal with the penalty for sin. The Bible says that the consequences of sin is death. The wages of sin is death. And the burnt offering was this amazing first time in history where God says it's okay for another animal to take the place of the sinner. That's an amazing thought, but how many animal lovers still think that's a bum deal? Like that an animal would have to die to take our place as sinners? That's really sad. And that's why some of us don't like reading Leviticus, because there's a lot of animals that die in the book of Leviticus. And the burnt offering, you bring the whole animal, not parts, but you bring the whole thing. And as the priest is sacrificing the animal, the priest, this is really gross, puts his hand on the head of the animal so as to identify this animal is taking our place. That's the burnt offering. Jesus offered the whole of himself. Not part of himself. He didn't do some things. He gave his whole life. He willingly laid down his life, taking our place to deal with our sin and paying the cost and consequence of that sin so that he could also conquer the power, which is something the burnt offering could never do. Jesus is our most perfect burnt offering. He's our whole offering, giving all of himself for you and me. Second, we talked about the grain offering. The grain offering was a voluntary offering that someone was free to give in praise and thanksgiving of God's goodness and provision, i.e. grain, because they had to grow the grain, right? So they would bring a grain offering, but there were rules. You couldn't mix yeast into the grain offering because yeast represented sin. And it had to be a yeastless offering because it had to be a sinless offering. But you were supposed to mix in salt, because salt was a sign of the covenant, this old covenant that God gave his people. Salt is a preservative, right? And the idea was this covenant preserves the relationship that God has with his people. So we bring this grain offering in thanks and praise for God's goodness and provision. Jesus is the only truly sinless offering that has ever been given for us. Jesus is God's goodness and provision in the flesh. And on the night that he gave himself up for us, he gathered with his disciples. He took bread without yeast, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Receive the goodness and provision of God." Third, we talked about the fellowship offering, which is also known as the peace offering. And what I love about the fellowship offering, it might be my favorite because it's a meal. A portion was given to the Lord, and a portion was given to the priests, and the rest was a meal that the offerers would come together and eat at the altar. And they would celebrate that God has done what was necessary to establish peace between us and him and us with one another. So therefore, we have fellowship with God and with one another. That meal that Jesus shared with his disciples on his final night, he redefined as his body broken and his blood poured out so that we could have peace with God forever. So that continuing to make offerings wasn't needed anymore. We don't have to continue to bring the Levitical offerings because Christ is the once and for all offering that has made peace between us and God. And by him, we have fellowship with God and fellowship with one another. So even though we don't offer the Levitical offerings anymore, we still celebrate that meal that Jesus gave to his first disciples. We're going to be sharing and celebrating it next Sunday. I hope you'll come back for it. Because by that meal that celebrates the sacrifice that Christ gave, we have fellowship with God and each other. The last two are the sin offering and the guilt offering. And the sin offering probably sounds like the things that we do wrong, right? We bring an offering because we do something wrong. But actually, sin is not just doing wrong stuff. Sin is anything that separates us from our holy God. And what's important about the sin offering is that most often it was to address unintentional sin, sins committed out of ignorance, or things that weren't even a moral issue that people would be exposed to that would make them ritually unclean and impure. And you can read all about what that means in the book of Leviticus. But the point of it, the reason this offering is really important, is because it highlights the fact that the human condition is corrupted by sin and there's nothing we can do about it. Try as we might, even if we try to be a perfectly moral person, there will always be things that separate us from God. There will be things that happen outside of our control that expose us to things that separate us from God and cause destructive patterns in our life. The sin offering is here to deal with that. Jesus is our ultimate sin offering. Because Jesus didn't just take on sin's penalty, Jesus took on sin's power, defeating it so that we could be purified once and for all and actually receive a new nature through him. Purified not by blood, but by the pure and clean waters of baptism by which God makes us new so that we are acceptable to God forever and permanently have access to his presence. Isn't that amazing? Like, we might just take that for granted and realize that Jesus has done once what the people of God had to do over and over and over. And finally, the guilt offering. And this was the offering to pay the debt for when we had wronged somebody so that forgiveness could be given and reconciliation could happen. Jesus paid our sin debt once and for all. He leads us into a life of giving and receiving forgiveness so that reconciliation can be possible. And our sins won't be held against us. Through Jesus, we can now stand in the presence of a holy God, guilt-free, shame-free, forgiven and redeemed as God continues to make us new every day from glory to glory. Jesus is the fulfillment of the book of Leviticus. Every one of these offerings point to him, the ultimate work that God had to do through him, because all the sacrifices of Leviticus could only deal with the outward manifestation of sin. They could only cover sin up. They could not remove sin from the inside. And Jesus, God says through Jesus, I have a better way. I don't just want worshipers at my altar. I want my children altered. I want their hearts changed. I want their souls cleansed and purified. I don't want them to keep offering animal after animal and still be unchanged. I want them to experience victory and newness of life. So Jesus, his death, his resurrection, has altered everything. And we've been going through this sermon series called Altered, based on a book by Susan Kent. And we've been learning about experiencing God's transforming power through the act of surrender. That's what altars are about. They're places of surrender. And I tell you today that there is no greater altar of surrender than the cross of Jesus Christ, where he freely laid down his life. It is the greatest altar story in the Bible. It is the one that all other altar stories point to. And there is no greater example of God's transforming power than the empty tomb. How many of you remember this planter from a few weeks ago? 2 weeks ago, we had this same planter on the altar table, and it had dirt, and I invited you to write your sins down on paper so that we could bury them and leave them buried. So much of the time, we like to drudge up what God has already dealt with and forgiven, and we were invited that day to bury our sins, leave them buried, and watch them be covered underneath the cross. And today, this same planter with this same dirt, and we kept our promise, nobody has read your sins. They have been buried in this dirt. But today we celebrate that God doesn't just cover over our sins. He comes in to the sinful places of our hearts and the places of death in our world, and he brings forth life. That God has done something so remarkable in Jesus that it alters everything. And Matthew wants us to see this, so he gives us a bunch of signs. So are you ready to go from Leviticus and step back into Matthew? Can we do that? Okay, hard shift. We're going from the old covenant back into the new, from Leviticus back into Matthew. And we already read this earlier, but I want to highlight some of the signs that Matthew gave that we read a few minutes ago. First, he said the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and we talked about how that was a sign that God has left the temple. What Matthew wants us to see is Jesus' death and resurrection have changed everything. And this change, this is the biggest word I'm going to throw at you, is a covenantal change. It's a covenantal change because that curtain was part of the old covenant. It had always been there. There had always been some physical separator between God and his people, and that curtain was torn in two. God has ushered in a new covenant through the death and resurrection of Jesus, a covenantal change. The next sign we see is the earthquake. The earth shook, rocks split open, tombs broke open. Now, earthquakes were common in Jesus' day because Palestine is on a fault line. And so earthquakes weren't that uncommon, but they were commonly associated with God's presence and activity. And the timing just lined up perfectly because all of this stuff is happening together as Jesus is giving up his spirit. And so the earth shaking is like a natural change. And part of what I think God is trying to communicate is I'm not just changing my people. This is changing the world. Like this event is changing everything. This is a natural cosmic change. But what wasn't natural was rocks splitting open. So this is also a material and physical change, just as Jesus physically walked on the water and calmed the seas. Jesus has power over the natural. The tombs broke open and holy people who had died were raised to life. Did you catch that part? Like, that's not in any other gospel. Mark, Luke, John. I read that and I was like, okay, we're reading that Sunday because that's just amazing. We might miss that little detail. But then, did you notice Matthew catches himself and he says, well, they came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection. Like, he's in Good Friday, but he can't help talk about Easter. Like, he's gotta talk about the death and resurrection together because it's what God is doing in the whole package. And these are all the signs. And this sign, the tombs breaking open and holy people being raised from the dead, is showing that Jesus is the first and others are to follow. And because of those first followers that were raised from the dead, you and I can count on looking forward to that final day of resurrection when we too will be raised like Jesus and with Jesus. This is a spiritual change, but it's a bodily change too, right? Humans no longer have to suffer death. Do you know what this really is? This is no less than the reversal of the direction that the world is spinning in. Because if you think about it, the story starts with life, right? God creates everything. And after life, sin. And sin gives way to death. So God comes up with a plan to deal with that, and he offers forgiveness. But ultimately, he needs to send the ultimate sacrifice, Jesus. And through his death and resurrection, we have new life so that we're back to where we started. And ever since then, we still look around and see this today. It looks like life gives way to death because everything that lives dies, right? God says, not anymore. Through the death and resurrection of Jesus, I have literally reversed the curse, and now death gives way to life. Don't believe it any other way. Because of Jesus' death and resurrection, the curse is reversed, and now death gives way to life. The dead things in our lives that we're actively dealing with, God can bring life from. Death itself is no longer something for us to fear because God brings forth life. The witnesses saw all this and were terrified. The centurion, the other guards, they saw everything that happened and they were terrified. The women who came to the tomb before the angel told them not to be afraid, they were terrified. I would call this an emotional change, right? So we've seen a covenantal change, a physical change, a natural change, a spiritual change, an emotional change, and finally, even though they're terrified, they exclaim, surely he was the Son of God, a theological change. God has revealed something that the world up to this point has never known, and that is that Jesus is his Son, Jesus is our Savior, and Jesus is Lord of all, and not even death can keep him down. And so God invites us to experience each one of these changes as we encounter the good news of Easter in a fresh way this year. I wonder, as you look around, what in the natural world you know needs to be changed by God's resurrection power? What in your own life, what maybe physically, medically, needs God's special attention? Do you need to surrender to him and believe his transforming power to be able to either make a change or help you persevere through it? Because it's not the ultimate truth. Easter is the ultimate truth, even when it looks like other things are calling the shots. I wonder if in your life you have emotional needs that need to be altered by the good news of Easter, spiritual needs that need to be altered by the good news of Easter. Do you believe Jesus is who Matthew is giving us all these signs to point to and say, this is what God is doing. This is who this is. Everything is different now. Even you can be changed. So we're going to spend the next 6 weeks talking about what that change looks like and what that new life looks like that Jesus invites us into. He preached a whole sermon about it. We're going to take 6 weeks going through his sermon saying, okay, Jesus, what does it look like to really be changed and have a life that is in alignment with you? Because the problem is we look around, we look at our own lives, we look at our spheres of influence, our communities, our world, and it doesn't look like Easter has altered everything, does it? I mean, is it okay to admit that in church? Like, it's one thing to come in here and say, okay, Easter's altered everything. And then we go eat lunch, and then we go home, and we turn on the news, and we say, man, I don't think anything's altered. Like, I'm glad everything's altered at Mulder, and I'm glad we can talk about everything being altered for that 1 hour, but then we get back to life. And it's like, it doesn't look like Easter's calling the shots, right? Easter's the farthest things from our minds sometimes when we're experiencing real life and we're watching the news. I watch the same news you do. And here's why. Because even as we look around in this world and we see things that are out of alignment with God and his values and his character, his design, even though we see death in a world that is bursting with life, flowers are blooming, pollen is spreading all over our cars, and yet death still seems to run rampant. Destruction seems to run rampant, right? Unforgiveness rather than reconciliation, war rather than peace, hate rather than love, racism and prejudice rather than a love for diversity. Echo chambers rather than curiosity, polarization rather than empathy, pride rather than humility, and self-preservation instead of the selfless, sacrificial love that God demonstrates in Jesus? Why do we still see all of that and have to contend with it if Easter has changed everything? And here's the answer: because God does not force himself upon us. God has altered everything. God is altering everything. And when Jesus comes back, God's alteration project will be complete. And in the meantime, he is still altering human hearts and the world in which we live. The choice is to see it through the lens of Easter and to say, God, I want to let you. Because God will not force himself upon us. God is offering us the greatest change we could ever experience, and he's offering for us to be a part of his changing work and activity in the world. But we have to choose it. We have to choose, like the pagan onlookers, to see through the lens of Easter, surely this man is the Son of God. Surely Easter does change everything. Surely in a world that, when I look around, it threatens to call the shots and it looks like death and decay and destruction and power grabbing are the order of the day, I say that Jesus still rules and reigns, and he's Lord of all. I believe that. And every time we believe that, every time we surrender to the reality of Easter, we're putting up an altar. We're putting up an altar. And the great news today is that God has left the temple. And so I want to conclude this series as we celebrate the greatest day in human history with a vision that we started casting at the beginning of this sermon series, and that is that no longer do we have to come to a specific place, to a specific altar, to make sacrifices, to encounter the transforming power of God's presence. Now we can do it wherever we are. Because God has left the temple, we are invited to come to the altar wherever we are. Wherever we yield to Easter instead of yielding to the world's narrative, whenever we believe that God's yes to life is louder than death's no, whenever we believe that the life that Jesus invites us to is greater than anything else the world could offer, we are putting up an altar of surrender, and we are claiming ground for God. And I think what God would love to see as a result of this Easter day is altars everywhere. Altars everywhere, in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our community. When you're driving your kids to school or your grandkids and you're in the car line, Easter is probably the last thing from your mind. But when you pause in that moment and you choose to take spiritual authority over your family and you begin giving God thanks and you pray his provision and his protection and his goodness over your kids and their classmates and their teachers and their school, you are making an altar out of your car or your pickup or your minivan. When you're sitting at your desk at work, when it feels like the least sacred place in the world, and you pause and you say, God, regardless of what's going on in the hallways and the offices around me and the cubicles and the conference rooms, I am declaring that you are still the risen Lord. And I want my life and my heart to be in alignment with you. So God, would you alter my heart so that I could get up from this desk and be a witness to Jesus in the place where you have me? The moment you do that, you have made a secular place a sacred altar. You've come to the altar where you are. And every time you find a spot in your home and you open the Word of God, knowing you're probably not going to understand half of it, but you have a spirit of expectation anyway, that the God who wrote it is living and active, and he actually desires to speak directly to you as you seek him in prayer, seek him with all your heart. He promises that you'll find him the moment that you do that in your own home, in an armchair, on your back porch. You are putting up a sacred altar. The amazing news about Easter is that Christ is risen, that God has left the temple, that he can and wants to be found everywhere. So come to the altar wherever you are. So I'm going to invite you to stand this morning as we sing our closing song. And the invitation is going to be a little different than what it has been, because for the past 6 weeks, we've been inviting you to physically come to the altar up here, because there's something special about that, right? When our bodies lead our souls and we actually put ourselves in motion and choose to come to God. And that invitation will be open anytime the doors of this church are open. You're welcome to come up here to the kneelers or the steps, use it as an altar. But more than that, I don't want to reinforce the idea that we can only come to the altar here in a special place during a special hour, one day a week, and then when we leave, God stays here just like he stayed in the temple. I want to invite you to practice coming to the altar where you are so that as we leave, we know that God leaves with us and we can continue to come to the altar wherever we are again and again and again. So I want to invite you, if you want to come forward and you need to spend time with God up here, you're welcome to do that. This will never be closed off to you. But where you're standing, maybe you feel like just sitting in silence in the presence of God. Maybe you want to turn around and use your chair as a kneeler and just make an altar out of where you are. Let's practice coming to the altar right here. God, we thank you that through Easter, you did something that you had never done before. You gave access to yourself through the death and resurrection of your son, Jesus, our perfect sacrifice, our ultimate offering. You gave full permanent access to the presence of God. God, we pray that today we would realize what a big deal that is, that we would realize that you want to change our hearts, you want to change our lives, not just in this place today, but everywhere we go. And so right now, Holy Spirit, we pray that you would help us come to the altar right where we are. If there's anything on our hearts, on our souls, on our consciences, if there's anything with guilt and shame attached, Lord, would you help us right now to turn that over to you? God, if there's anything that we need forgiveness for, would you help us turn that over to you? God, if there are reasons that we can give you praise and thanksgiving today for your goodness and your provision, would you help us just pour that out to you in song and in prayer? God, help us come to the altar. And as we leave, help us come again and again and again and again. In Jesus, the risen Christ's name, amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
As you leave this place today, hear this good news. Christ is risen. God has left the temple. So go and come to the altar. Wherever you are. Happy Easter. God bless you. Grace and peace.
The precious blood of Jesus.